We're glad that you are here with us this morning. Our time of worship is very precious to me, so I really am grateful that you're all here with me. Some of you will be aware that Trevor McLean's father passed away during the week. The funeral will be on Tuesday, the 2nd of February at 11 a.m. at the Manukau Memorial Gardens down in Auckland. Let's stand and sing our opening song, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
Of Jesus' name, let angels rush and fall, let angels rush straight fall, bring forth the royal diadem, and
it's our wish to crown you this morning, Lord of our lives, Lord of this place, and Lord indeed of all the earth. Thank you that you have given us the gift of your Son. Thank you that we can come to you as we are. Thank you for all that you do for us. Amen. As you can see, we have the elements out for communion this morning. Now, when I was growing up, I grew up in the Open Brethren Church, and communion was just part of how we did things. Every Sunday, we would have communion. And I joined the Salvation Army. You can see the attraction. And it was different in the Salvation Army. We didn't do communion. So it got me to thinking, why is it? Why is it that some people do communion and some people don't? And to me, it sort of became something different, something special that I would hold on to when it happened, but I could let it go. It wasn't the be-all and end-all of a Sunday meeting. Not for me, anyhow. I know that there are faiths that have that as part of their normal regime. And for them, that's cool. Salvation Army were a little bit different. And I praise God for that difference. Our theology around it is not strictly theology. It's more practical service in that when the Salvation Army was being created, a lot of drunkenness, a lot of over-imbibing, shall we say, in the in wine and stuff like that meant that the Salvation Army's view was, we're not going to do that because we're trying to actually save and help the people who are addicted to alcohol. So that's one of the reasons why we pulled away. The other reason that my research chose me is that for some people, communion almost became an idol. And so we stepped away. We believe in communion and in the spirit-led emblems that we have here, but we don't make it the centre point of our meeting. So that's sort of where I've come to from a person who had very regular experiences of communion, and I can tell you I've had some great experiences of communion. One of the most fabulous I ever had was one where we were at Main Stage. This was a predecessor of the Parachute Music Festival, and it was held on the banks of the Otaki River down near Wellington. And Sunday morning we had communion, and there must have been sort of 20 to 30,000 of us. And our emblems for the day were Coca-Cola and chips. It's not the symbols, it's what they represent. So on that part, I'll read you from Mark's Gospel, chapter 14, verse 22. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body." Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, gave it to them, and they all drank from it. He said to them, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many. Assuredly, I say to you, I will no longer drink of the fruit of the vine until that day I drink it anew in the kingdom of God." So it doesn't really matter if it's what we have here, the traditional bread and wine, Coca-Cola and chips. It is what it symbolizes. So we're going to partake in communion. While we're doing that, as part of the whole communion thing, I'd like you to bring your tithes and offerings up to these baskets here. We have some music for you to think about as we worship together in this form. Thank you.
This is the body, and this is the blood, broken and poured out for all of us. And in this communion, we share in His love. Body, and this is the blood. Well, I will remember everything, Lord, that You've done for me. I won't take for granted the sacrifice that set me free. I hunger and thirst for Your love. Come fill me today. This is the body, and this is the blood, broken and poured out for all of us. This is the blood.
Sacrifice made for us when Jesus died to atone for our sins. We thank you for these symbols that help us corporately and as individuals to remember and meditate. May we never come to rely on or place our faith in any ceremonies or symbols that have become dear to us. We would pray that everyone here this morning deeply understands and experiences the personal relationship with you that was made possible through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We ask that your Holy Spirit continues to work in our midst this morning. We welcome the promptings and the nudgings of your Spirit in this place and in our lives. Reveal to us any barrier that we have allowed to disrupt us from having a right relationship with you. We pray for the offerings that have been given this morning, that you will direct their use. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
We're going to sing again. I don't have my stars with me, so we've roped in
Tim. I don't know how to respond to that.
Another star.
Different stars.
Just before we do, I just wanted to share something that I was thinking about during communion. So this is something I always find really interesting. I remember someone once told me, I don't know if it's a true story or if it's an allegory, or just a fable type thing, but there were a group of monks who would pray every day, and on the place where they were praying, they had a cat, and the cat used to like to kind of come in and, you know, rub up against them and get in the way when they were praying. So what they would do every morning is before they prayed, they would tie the cat to the pole. And this happened. This continued for quite some time. And the people who got there first kind of didn't actually know this backstory. So when the cat died, there was this mass panic because how can we pray if we haven't tied the cat to the pole? And I think that one of the things with communion that that Dad alluded to is that, you know, we don't do it as much in the Salvation Army, but what I do really like is that the reminder to kind of, you know, remember why we do things and make things intentional. And so I think it's a cool opportunity for us to be intentional with what we do in our whole lives and remember, you know, why we do things. You know, think about the things that we do at church maybe and what things are, you know, awesome and fantastic and hear of God and what things are maybe tying a cat to a pole.
Yeah.
What a fun.
Thank you, Roseanne. So we're going to stand and we're going to sing about that God of wonders that we have and that he cares us.
God of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, the heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high, God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy, Lord of heaven and earth. Early in the morning, I will
Our next song is one that is definitely part of my tradition in the Brethren Church, and it's part of the tradition here. Blessed Assurance.
It's a declaration of what Jesus is to us. Think about that as we sing this morning. Come to you with that in mind, to praise our Saviour all the day long. I don't always get it right, Lord, I know that, but I praise you that I can come and praise you at any time, anywhere, any place. Thank you. Last Sunday of the month, it is actually the last day of the month, is normally a building fund offering. So we're going to put the
the hat out there, and if you've got something you wish to put in the building fund offering, please feel free as we sing the next song. Now, Ken tells me we've never sung this song before, but I don't believe him. So,
I'm sure people know it.
So we're going to sing together. Stay seated, and you know. You might remember last week I said it's been a crazy month for meeting leads and all, and because of Trevor's father being unwell, we've shifted it around and all the rest of it, and I'm very grateful for Peter Smith to bring his hand up and volunteering to lead us here this morning. So Peter, we're in your hands, brother.
Thanks, Kevin. Good morning, everybody. Welcome. And to those who are here for the first time, in this church for the first time, you are especially welcome. The Holy Spirit's at work in this place. Amen. Okay, so I've been quite excited about this all week, which is strange, but there's a good reason, because it was a strong message that I had to get up and speak what I heard. And what I heard was at the 11 o'clock meeting last week, during that service, we were privileged to hear testimony, and within that testimony, there was a profound message. In fact, prophetic utterings were spoken. What was prophesied was not new revelation, but words proclaimed publicly, to re-emphasize the word of God in Scripture. Amen. The words were of encouragement, and I believe they were words born of the Holy Spirit. We know this because these prophetic utterings were spoken in harmony with the Holy Scripture. The message was for the church and to the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Paul reminds the church in his first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 14, verse 3, "But the one who prophesies speaks to people for their strengthening, encouragement, and comfort." Amen. Okay, so speaking of prophetic utterings, Paul said in 1 Thessalonians 5, "Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good. Reject every kind of evil." Through the prophet, the Holy Spirit was speaking to this church to strengthen, encourage, and comfort the body of Christ. We need to listen and act, as there is a danger if we quench the Spirit or hold a negative attitude towards prophetic ministry. Amen. The message was that we, as a church, must recognize and encourage the outworkings of the spiritual gifts the Holy Spirit has empowered all who have repented and accepted Him into their lives. We must use the gifts we have been given. Amen. This church has so many spiritual service and working gifts bestowed on it and available to it. These gifts are the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. Gifts of the body and gifts for witness to the lost. The lost in the city are crying out. These gifts are not the natural talents possessed by believers or unbelievers. They are gifts sovereignly and supernaturally bestowed by the Holy Spirit to us believers, enabling us to edify each other to the glory of the Lord. Amen. When I first walked into this church a little over 4 years ago, I could see immediately how gifted this church is. I encountered and recognized outworkings of spiritual gifts immediately because that was what I was looking for. Unbeknown to me, that is what I was crying out for. I entered this place looking for good people. I now know those good people as spiritually gifted brothers and sisters. So let us examine the gifts of the Spirit. In 1 Corinthians 12, verse 1, "Now about the gifts of the Spirit, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed." The same applies today. Paul reminds us that we need to celebrate one another's gifts as they are edifying and that they instruct and improve and are a unifying influence in the church. So if we look at the context of Paul's message, Corinth was an important and wealthy city on the isthmus separating northern and southern Greece. The Apostle Paul spent about 18 months there on his second missionary journey and established a church there. The Corinthian church had many, many issues of immaturity. The problem was that members came to Christ out of the city of Corinth, a city plagued with immorality and filled with pagan idols. It was a huge challenge for Paul to take the church from that background and bring them to a place of spiritual maturity. The same is true for people today. We live in a culture very much like Corinth. Immorality is everywhere around us. And when someone comes to faith in Christ, there are many, many areas in a person's life that need to be transformed. The gifts of the Holy Spirit are necessary for this transformation. Amen. The Church of Corinth was certainly Christian and therefore had the presence of the Holy Spirit in them. The spiritual gifts were manifested amongst them, but here again, they were immature and needed Paul's instruction. The Word tells us that the Spirit of the living God is given to every person who receives Jesus Christ into their heart as Lord and Savior, and the Holy Spirit gives gifts to each person. Amen. So if we look through Corinthians and go through verses 4 to 11, and examine these gifts. Now there are various kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit. As Paul notes here, there's a variety of gifts. In verses 8 to 10, he lists 9 gifts. That list is not comprehensive, however, as there are other gifts. In Romans 12, Paul lists gifts of prophecy, ministry, teaching, exhorting, giving, leading, being compassionate. In Ephesians 4, he lists the gifts of being an apostle, a prophet, an evangelist, a pastor, and a teacher. Paul's point is, while there are many gifts, there is only one Spirit of God who gives them. They make him known, understood, and evident in the church and in the world. Amen. So verse 5, there's various kinds of service and the same Lord. We need to consider the many kinds of service that Christians render on a regular basis in our local church. These range from humble, sweeping floors, things like that, to the exalted. But we must be careful not to appreciate the more humble services less than we appreciate the more exalted ones. Each kind of service has a place in the economy of the kingdom. There are various kinds of workings, verse 6, but the same God who works things in all. All Christians are spiritually gifted in some way. Some, like Paul, have many gifts. We need to also remember that these spiritual gifts are really that, gifts. They come to us by the grace of God, amen, rather than by personal achievement. If we keep that in mind, it will give us a humble spirit if we happen to be among those who are especially gifted. Verse 7, but to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. The point of this verse is that all these gifts are given by the Spirit for that which is beneficial for the common good. Not for the exaltation of the gifted person. Many compare themselves to others and become very self-critical if their gift doesn't seem to be as great as someone else's. But such discouragement keeps us from enjoying the gifts God gave us, each and every one of us, and having freedom to develop that gift to its maturity. Verse 8. For to one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge, according to that, to the same Spirit. This is not human wisdom and knowledge. These are godly wisdom and knowledge, gifts given by the Holy Spirit to ensure that we understand God's word and his will and how we apply that understanding to life. Verse 9. To another, faith by the same Spirit, and to another, gifts of healing by the same Spirit. True faith will manifest itself in some sort of action. The possibilities for manifestation are endless. Not like healing, which is very specific. Faith also is also different in that all Christians possess faith. Therefore, we might think of it as the umbrella gift under which all the other gifts are gathered, like healing and working miracles, etc. Gifts of healing accomplish two things. First, they relieve the suffering of the person who is healed. Second, they equip the church to witness to the power of God in its midst. Amen. Verse 10, and to another workings of miracles, and to another prophecy. In the New Testament, Jesus worked many miracles, which served two purposes. First, they alleviate suffering. Second, they authenticated Jesus' ministry. In the Gospel of John, Jesus' miracles are called signs because they point to something larger than miracles than the miracles themselves. Jesus' disciples also worked miracles to authenticate their ministry. Prophecy. Jesus warned against false messiah and false prophets in Matthew. So how can we distinguish between true and false prophets today? Scripture speaks to us about how we can test. Does the message exalt Christ in John? Does it accord with Scripture, 2 Timothy? Does it build up the church, 1 Corinthians? Does it pronounce judgment on sin? Does it emphasize grace of God? Does it produce godly fruits, Matthew? There's no reason to believe that the Holy Spirit did not just give these sign gifts to the early apostolic church, but that they are still given in these days of ours. goes on, and to another the ability to distinguish between spirits. We are all known people whose reason we all know people whose reasoned judgment and gracious manner inspire our confidence, and there are the guardians and watchmen who protect the church from demonic lies and false doctrine. To another, various kind of tongues, and to another, the interpretation of languages. In Acts, Peter's sermon was heard by people from many nations, and each heard the sermon in his own language. Again, these gifts are given to those who make themselves available to receive it, to receive them. Verse 11, all these are empowered by one and the same Spirit, and he distributes them to each one just as he determines. Paul reiterates and emphasizes on the one and the same Spirit, found in verse 4 to 6 and verses 8 and 9. There are many gifts, but one Spirit who energizes all of them. The Spirit gives spiritual gifts to individuals as the Spirit wills. The emphasis here is more on the Spirit's authority than on the individual's distribution of gifts. The Spirit has a plan for distributing spiritual gifts and distributes them accordingly. So this brings me back to the prophetic word that was spoken last week. Use the gifts God gives you. God gives a variety of gifts, all from the same Spirit, and there are varieties of ministries and varieties of effects. But God works all things in all people. Amen. All of these come from God, and he expects us to use them to build up the church whom he loves. Amen. It makes sense that a variety of gifts and ministries and effects are needed. What if everyone had the same gift? So if we look at, as an illustration, we look at the construction of this building. What if everyone was an electrician working on site? Or what if everyone was a plumber? We wouldn't have a complete building. And sorry to the electricians, but it would be very expensive as well. God gives us gifts for the purpose of using them. The more you love him, the more you want to do something for him. Luke 12. From everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded. And from the one who has been entrusted with much, much more will be asked. Amen. There's a blessing and a joy and a satisfaction in knowing that you're living as God made you to live, that you're taking the gifts that he gave you and using them for his purpose in your life. An interviewer once asked an Olympic runner, his name was Eric Little, why he ran, and he answered, God made me fast, and when I run, I feel his pleasure. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. You'll recall, those of you who were with us last week, that we reflected on a song that I wish to continue introducing to the congregation. It's a old song with some additions. And I'll read you the traditional words. Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou biddest me come to thee. O Lamb of God, I come. So we're going to reflect on this song again. Those of you who were here last week, and those of you who know it, please feel free to sing along with the words as they come through. And feel free to be part of our congregation, our fellowship, our devotion to the Lord by kneeling at his mercy seat as he prompts you to do. The words are, just as I am, I come.
Just as I
Father God, I see in my heart you standing there with your arms wide open, just waiting for me to come. And I thank you from the bottom of my heart for what you have done for us. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
We're going to sing our benediction. So if the band will come and join us. So we're going to, you know, we've come, now we're going to go. We're going to go in the strength of the Lord. And I pray this strength of the Lord upon Trevor and his whānau this week. It's going to be a tough week for them. I pray his blessing upon him. So this is our benediction. Stand and sing with us, worship with us, praise God with us, and then go in his strength.
I'll go in the strength of the Lord, in passing his heart for my feet. I'll follow the light. No strength from the dangers I meet. His holiness my steps shall attend. His holiness my watch shall supply. On him till my journey shall end. Thank you.